So, and we'll share the chat also with you, sir. Wherever you can answer, please do it.
Okay. Okay. Sure. Yeah. Okay. Thank you so much, sir.
So, Tejo, can we go to the next and last part? So, I'm sure people are, must be 4 hours of listening must have been very difficult. But I guarantee that this part is not going to be difficult to listen because it doesn't involve a lot of science. And it involves more of what you see regularly as far as ventilator is concerned. So what I will do is I will just switch off my this. I will switch off everybody else except the current video. So can you see my screen, Tejo?
I can see, sir.
Okay.
I think maybe we need to put it as.
I will pin it.
Yeah, just pin it, sir, so that it will be. Yeah.
So I'll pin mine one so that. So is it okay now?
Letters are a little smaller, but yeah, first pin it. Sir, I think you need to pin it, sir. Still, it
I've
is.
I've done it. I've pinned it. So I request everybody to highlight only my video so that you will be able to see only my screen. So there will be some change in the thing, but as I keep writing, you will be able to, it will become very clear. So we will, now what we'll do is, we will see the hardware of a ventilator and we'll see the software of a ventilator. Can you hear me? And can we'll see how to troubleshoot problems of a ventilator. So these three we'll see first and then we'll go on to see CPAP and also humidification. Is it clear, Tejo? The voice is clear?
Yeah, voice is clear only, sir. Voice is clear. Can we zoom a little more while we are writing? Because almost 6 sentences it is happening.
Well, I will try to. Yeah, now?
Yeah, it's better. It's better, sir.
So we look at the hardware, we look at the software, and we look at the troubleshoot. Now, before we go to the hardware, from all the lectures, we have realized that when we are doing ventilation means we are giving oxygen, we are giving some pressures in ventilation. We talk about this pressure as P, some expiratory pressure and some inspiratory pressure. So we're giving 2 levels of pressure and we give this for a particular period of time, PE, for P and TI for the inspiratory time. Then we have to warm and humidify the gases whenever your ventilation or using CPAP. And this one of our friends, Venkat, will tell us why we need to humidify the gases when we are doing ventilation or CPAP. But all gases should be delivered at 37 degrees Celsius with 100% relative humidity to the endotracheal tube of the baby if it is ventilator or to the nose of the baby if it is a CPAP. Then we need something to detect the breath of the baby. So when the baby starts to inhale, if we can find out that, we can match the inspiration of the ventilator or the inspiratory pressure of the ventilator with the baby's inspiratory effort. So that is what is triggered. So we need something to pick up the inspiratory effort of the baby, and that happens with the flow sensor. The more of this you will learn when you're talking about the patient trigger ventilation. Then something called termination sensitivity, which you will learn in patient trigger ventilation or PSV. This measures the flows which are going to the patient. Patient flows are being monitored, and based on the quantity of flow which goes to the patient, the expiration is terminated. So for some modes of ventilation, you need termination sensitivity, and this again is possible because of flow sensor. Flow sensor measures the flows, the volumes which are going to the patient and at the level of endotracheal tube. Then you need, modern ventilators also have facilities to measure the volumes, and to measure the volumes again you have flow sensors. So the flow sensor which we have in a ventilator will identify when the baby started breathing, will identify how much flow is going into the baby, what is the peak flow, when the flow has started reducing into the baby, and it will also measure how much volume of gas is going into the baby and how much of volume of gas is coming out from the baby. So a ventilator means it needs to have all this. Modern ventilators have capacity to deliver oxygen, and we know that we measure oxygen in FiO2, fraction of oxygen going to the patient. We need to deliver pressures, PIP and PEEP, for prefixed times of PI and TE. We need to humidify the gas before goes to the patient. We need a way by which we can identify the triggering of the baby. We can identify the flows going to the baby, and we can quantify the volumes going to the baby. So these, if you have all this capacity, it becomes a ventilator. So what do you need for all this? So for all this, because you need oxygen, and you need oxygen to go from 21 to 100%, we cannot go below 21%. So you need 21% to 100% capacity to go from oxygen from 21 to 100%. So for 21%, we need compressed air source. Air has oxygen, 21% oxygen. So you need a compressed air source. And for 100% oxygen, you need a compressed oxygen source, O2 source. So this will give 21% oxygen, this will give 100% oxygen. But to mix these two, because we can get 21, 25, 30, 40, 45, whatever we want, we have to titrate. So for that, for mixing this compressed air and oxygen, we need a blender. We need a blender. And so suppose you are setting FiO2 to 30%. So you are taking some air, some oxygen, these two are mixed, and the blender gives 30%. So to ensure that the blender is giving 30%, you need to measure the oxygen which is coming out of this blender. So we need a FiO2 monitor or a FiO2 sensor. So you see here, just for getting correct oxygen, you need a compressed air source, we need a compressed oxygen source, we need a blender, and to see cross-check the function of a blender, you need FiO2 monitor. So these basically four components you need just for ensuring that you are giving the correct oxygen concentration to the baby. Now, what do we need for a pressure? For pressure and timing, we just need a T-piece. All ventilators work on the concept of a T-piece. Now I'll tell you how the T-piece can give you PIP and how it can give you the time of TE and time of TE. So, but basically it is a T-piece, which means you need an inspiratory limb, you need a patient, and you need an expiratory limb. If you have an inspiratory limb, the patient and expiratory limb and a test lung or a baby lung, then you can generate pressures. How do we generate pressures? We'll see subsequently. Now, so we need some circuit connected to the patient, which should be a sealed circuit, or there should be a closed circuit, and you need gas flows in this. Then only we can generate the pressures and for the time which you want. So the next thing is, for measurement of flows and gases, you need some device which fits here, which is a flow sensor, which measures the gas going into the patient and gas coming out of the patient, from the circuit into the patient and from the patient to the circuit. So that device which measures the gases going into the patient and coming out from patient is called a flow sensor. A flow sensor measures the flow, means how much gas is going per minute, and volume means in particular time how much volume has gone into the lung and how much volume has come out. If you know the flow, multiply with time, you'll get the volume. So you can know how much volume has gone into the baby with every breath and how much volume has come out with every breath. For 1 minute, how much gas has gone in, how much gas has come out, you can know from the flow sensor. So if you know per breath, it will become tidal volume. If you know per minute, it will become a minute volume. So these are the basic requirements of a hardware of a ventilator. So now let us put up the requirements of a ventilator. So let us see how we get a ventilator. So we said we need compressed air, compressed oxygen. And these have to mix inside a chamber. And how much air and how much oxygen comes in is based on a blender. So based on a blender. So this blender will have, say, rotatory wheels by which if you rotate the blender, the amount of air and how much of oxygen will keep varying coming into the chamber. So this air and oxygen comes with 30 to 50 pounds per second pressure. The compressor pressure is 30 to 50 pounds per square inch. So air and oxygen pressures in cylinders are these high pressures. So these high pressure gases are coming into the blender, and that is why a blender, normal blender, needs cannot work like that. So it is not just air and oxygen flows. High pressure air, high pressure oxygen, they need to be mixed. That is why you need a very good mechanical blender which can take care of high pressure air and oxygen. And why do we need such high pressures? To drive gases from the manifold till the ventilators. Sometimes the manifolds of oxygen are in the cellar and the ventilators are in the fifth or sixth floor. So, and there could be some leaks in the circuits. So to generate, to make the gas flows from the place of production till it comes to the ventilator, you need to have adequate pressures. That is why, as a universal standard, this will be at 15 to 30 to 50 pounds per second on both air and oxygen pressures. Now the blender will allow, based on the FiO2 which you set, the blender will allow air and oxygen in the proportion based on FiO2 which you set. So from this, the gas goes into a low pressure chamber because this much pressure is not required for the patient. So from a high pressure chamber, the gas goes to a low pressure chamber, and from here, in this low pressure chamber, you have a FiO2 monitor. So which measures actually whether this set FiO2 is matching with the delivered FiO2 or not. And from here, the gas is come out, and here you need a flow meter. So the flow meter will tell us how much gas should come into the circuit. So how much gas should come into the inspirator limb. The flow meter decides the quantity of gas. The blender decides the quality of gas. So you need a blender to titrate how much air and oxygen is coming into the circuit, and you need a flow meter to see how much of gas comes into the circuit. We already discussed that normally for all conventional ventilations, you require 6 to 8 liters per minute of flow in the circuit. This is almost 3 to 5 times the minute volume of most of the newborns. That is why you don't have to think much about the flow in most of the newborns. In high frequency ventilator, this goes almost to 15 liters per minute. The flow automatically gets adjusted to 15 liters per minute when you're switching from conventional to HFO. So from a high pressure chamber, low pressure chamber, FiO2 monitor, flow meter, the gas comes out. Now this gas is cold and dry. Why it is cold and dry? Whenever you compress any gas, it will become cold. And whenever you decrease the temperature of any gas, the water in that, moisture in that, get condensed. So to whenever somebody compresses the gas, they will take out the moisture. So the compressed gases are dry gases. So whatever you get out of these compressors, they are all cold and dry. Cold means low temperature, dry means low moisture. So since these gases, if they go into the airway, they can damage the lungs of the babies and for that matter children. So we need to have a good humidifier. So we need to have a humidifier. So which delivers the gas at 37 with 100% RH, relative humidity. And this our friend Venkat will tell us why it is like that. So you need a chamber like that. where the gas comes in, gets warm and humidified, and now from there the gas is in the inspirit limb. And in the inspirit limb, the gas gets heated, comes to the lung, and there is an expirator limb. So the gas is flowing in the inspirator limb and expirator limb. Intermittent only the gas will go in and come out of the vein. So this is where a flow sensor is measuring the gas going in, coming out. What is coming into the circuit and what is coming away from the patient but continue to flow in the circuit is partly circuit flow and partly the gas coming from the patient. Now, how do we build pressure in this? Is where you have to understand that so to generate pressure here, what we are doing is very simple. I'll just enlarge this. So you have the gas flowing continuously like that, and you have patient air coming and going out, and you have a flow sensor here. Now, if the gas is flowing out like this and the patient is connected to the flowing gas, what will happen? It will only suck the patient gas into the circuit, and this is called Bernoulli principle. Whenever the gas is flowing, the lateral pressure will be decreased and will suck everything from the sides, and that is the concept of river Ganga keeping the banks clean. When a Ganga is flowing, the banks are clean because it will pull everything from the beaches into it and then take away all the waste. So if the only gas is flowing like this, it sucks the air from the lung. So you want some of this gas going to the patient. So how can you do that? So what you do is you create a resistance here. You don't allow the gas to come out completely. This resistance will create a resistance to gas flow in the circuit and create some pressure in the tube, and this pressure is the PEEP pressure. This is the PEEP pressure. Now you create another valve in this, which is slightly bigger than that. And if you increase the resistance, because the gas is not able to come out, you get, this is a PIP pressure. So when you have only this valve, you get P. So if this valve comes down like that to that level, you get P. But if this valve increases in size, the resistance increases, you start getting PIP. So what they do is, you can have a single valve. For some time it is at this level when the PIP is delivered, and for some time it is at this level when PEEP is delivered. So the valve keeps moving up and down. So initially there is no valve. So once you set your PEEP, the valve will become, say, this much. So let's assume this is 5 cm pressure. So the valve came to this level. Now you have set a PIP of 15. So it will increase in size from this level to this level. So the valve here goes up. The pressure builds in the tube to 15. Once the pressure in the tube becomes 15, stays there till your TI is over. Stays there till your TI is over. After TI is over, the valve comes down, stays at the PEEP level for TE time. And once TE is over, it goes up. So when the valve is that level, pressure of 15, stays there for TI, comes down, it is PEEP pressure, and again stays there for the entire TE. So this shifting of valve is what is TI and TE. It is not the baby breathing. It is just how much time the PIP is there in the tube, how much time the PEEP is there in the tube is the TI and TE of a ventilator. So what goes into the baby and what comes into the baby is baby's respiration. So you may not have the same TI, TE for the baby, but what is there in the circuit is the TI of PEEP, PIP, and TE is for PEEP. And how do we achieve this? Based on this resistance which we created to the gas flow. All of you are clear? Any doubts on that? How did we create pressure? We made gas to flow in the circuit. We connected the circuit to the patient and we created an obstruction. this obstruction we are increasing and decreasing for the TI and TE time to get the pip pressure and peep pressure in the circuit. And once these pressures are there in the circuit, the same pressures will go to the patient. So when, suppose initially, when you started ventilation, the gas was coming from the lungs to the patient, to the circuit, because the gas flow is like this, lateral pressure will suck air. Now once you create a PEEP, there is some resistance in the tube. So P, 5 centimeter pressure built up in the tube. Now the gas will start going to the patient. The lung will inflate. The pressure in the lung becomes 5 centimeter. Now excess gas will leak out to the atmosphere. And once the TE is over, this valve increases in size. The pressure in the tube becomes 15 centimeter. Now since the pressure is high, here is only 4-5, the lung inflates further. Now the pressure in the lungs become 15 centimeter. No more gas flows here. Excess gas will leak out to the atmosphere. So you see that when the pressure in the tube is more than the pressure in the lung, the gas will flow into the lung till the pressure in the lung is equal to the pressure in the tube. Once the pressure in the tube increases from 5 to 15, again the gas will flow till the pressure in the lung becomes from 5 to 15. Now once you decrease this resistance from 15 to 5, what happens again? The pressure in the tube becomes 5. The lung pressure is still 15. So the gas will flow reverse. The lung will deflate, but remain at 5 centimeter pressure because the tube pressure is 5. Once the lung deflates, pressure in the lung becomes 5. Tube pressure is 5. Excess gas will leak out to the atmosphere. So this is what a ventilator is doing. Now, how do we ensure that these valves are moving, PEEP and PEEP valves, they're moving appropriately? And for this, you need a software. A software controls this PIP PEEP valve for the TI and TE. So you have a computer chip, which is the gas is flowing. You are just, during TI, you are pushing up. During TE, you are pulling down. And you increase the PIP, you push it up more. And you increase the TE, you keep that for longer time. And if you increase the, suppose PEEP is 4, and you want to increase the PE, you just keep increase the PE, PEEP valve. And from there, the PEEP again keep changes. So basically what it is doing is the computer is regulating this PEEP valve. And the pressures in these two are measured. And this feedback goes to the computer. So the feedback of the pressures in the circuit goes to the computer, and the computer will regulate the valve, expiratory valve. So the brain of a ventilator is actually the expiratory valve, because it's an expiratory valve. If there is a continuous flow gas, generates PEEP, measures the PEEP and PEEP and gives the feedback to the computer, and the computer will tell you how much time the PEEP and PEEP has to be there. Now, I showed you a simplified version of creating resistance. Now, in none of the ventilators you have a physical valve like that. Many of the ventilators have solenoid valves, which are valves like this, which are electrical valves, magnetic valves. They create current between these two. So more current, more resistance of gas flow. Less current, less resistance. So during PEEP, the resistance in these two valves will increase and create resistance to gas flow. During PEEP, the resistance will come down. So just by changing the current in these solenoid valves, you can change the resistance to gas flow, thereby change the pressures in the tube. So first was a physical valve. Second was a solenoid valve. The third method of creating resistance is, you can have a diaphragm here. So the gas is flowing like that, and you have a diaphragm here. So what it does is, during PEEP, diaphragm is like this. During PEEP, it is even more front. So it is obstructing the gas flow to come out to the atmosphere. So PEEP, 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 PEEP. So this valve is moving up and down to create resistance to the gas flow for generating PIP and PEEP. So what, by three methods, we are generating the pressures in the tube. That is a physical valve, a mechanical electronic valve, and a diaphragm. So different ventilators will have different methods of generating the pitch point fee, but all will have the same concept of gas flowing the circuit and creating resistance. In a bubble CPAP, how the pressure builds up, I think Sai will tell us. Now there are other methods. Instead of a valve, you can have a reverse flow. You can have two reverse flows. So here, this is a PEEP flow, and this is a PAT flow. So you have, say, this is coming at 6 liters per minute. So you obstruct with 2 liters per minute to get the PEEP, and you obstruct with 4 liters per minute to get the PAT. So this is another method. So the different methods of creating resistance to the gas flow to generate the pressures in the tube. So people have used different ventilators, use different methods of creating the pressures of PIP and PEEP. Some machines use solenoid valves, some machines use diaphragms, and some machines use reverse flows. So now we have seen, so all ventilators will remain the same. The baby, and from there, a expiratory valve. And this expiratory valve is guided with a software. And measurements of pressures are relayed to the software. The flows which are going into the patient and coming out from the patient, again, this is again relayed to the software, so that the software measures exactly the flows, exactly the volumes. And this software, when the baby starts inspiring, that is triggering, it says this, it detects here, it tells the software that baby started breathing. So you start your PAP valve. That is triggering. Once the baby starts inflating, it gives a message to the software, and the software will change the PEEP valve to PAP valve. As soon as the baby starts inspiring, that is triggering. And for volumes, it will measure here and then display to the software, and the software will say. This is what a ventilator is. All ventilators are same. Now, we have finished the hardware. So we have looked at the hardware requires. Hardware of a ventilator requires compressed air source, compressed oxygen source, a blender, then a low pressure and a high pressure chamber, then FiO2 monitor, then a flow meter, then a humidifier, and flow of gases in an expiratory limb, and a baby to connect to the ventilator circuit, and an expiratory valve assembly. The software of a ventilator is measuring pressures in the tubes, measures pressures in the tubes, that is circuit, measures volumes or flows going to the patient, titrates the TI and DE. Okay, so this is what the software is doing. And if you see any panel of a ventilator, on the software part, you will have set knobs. Then there are alarm knobs. Lastly, the display or measurement knobs. All ventilators will have only this: set knobs, alarm knobs, display knobs. In the display, you can have a digital display or a graphical display. That's all. All ventilators will have only these three things. In some place, you will see a set knobs, and you see a group of alarm knobs, and you see a group of display knob. In display, there will be digital and a graphical. So this finishes the hardware and the software component of a ventilator. So now let us see where are the troubleshoots you have. Suppose air and oxygen. Suppose 30 to 50 should be the pressure. If there is a difference in pressures in these two, the ventilator give an alarm saying that if the difference in these two is 15% difference in pressure is there, the blender will give an alarm. Blender alarm. You must have heard sometimes. Blender alarm, very squeaky, difficult to hear alarm. The other thing is, if there is decreased pressure in the air, it gives you a low inlet air alarm. If this is not working, then it gives low inlet oxygen alarm. So blender alarm, when the pressure differences are more than 15%, when compressed air is not working, inlet air alarm, when oxygen is not working, inlet oxygen alarm. And we said from there, the blender has to be there. Then you have the low pressure chamber. Then we have a FiO2 monitor here. Suppose you set 30% here, but here only 25% display, then it will tell you low FiO2 alarm. Low FiO2 alarm. Low FiO2 alarm could be your blender is not malfunctioning or your FiO2 monitor is malfunctioning. So if the difference between these two is 5%, you will get a low FiO2 alarm. If the difference is less than 5%, you will not get an alarm. Up to 5% difference between these two, the FiO2 monitor accepts this as a normal thing. Now the flow one, the flow meter, many of the modern ventilators do not have a flow meter. They're auto set flows, but you can set 4, 6 to 8 liters flow. This flow should be set in such a way that you get a sine wave. We have discussed about that. You should never get a square wave when you're ventilating any baby. If you're getting square wave with 8 liters, decrease to 7. If you're getting square wave with that, decrease to 6. The pressure rise should be gradual and not sudden. If you give high flows, the pressure buildup in the circuit will be rapid. If you give normal flows, the pressure in the circuit gradually rises, plateaus and comes down. So the flow meter usually does not cause problems, but there could be some dust in the flow meters which could cause decreased flow into the patient. Then the humidifier problems, I think Venkat will tell us. And from there, circuit problems, nothing much, but try to use disposable circuit as much as possible. And last, the valve assembly problems also could be there, that there could be sometimes water here. If it's a diaphragm, it could get stuck. Or if there is a reverse flow, one of the flow could be problematic. Or if it is a mechanical valve, the valves can get junk and they may not move easily. So a lot of problems could be there in the valve assembly. And if there is a problem in the valve assembly, you will not be able to deliver adequate pressures to the patient. Then you have to call the engineer and see where the problem is. Sometimes I'll show you how to do it yourself on the valve assembly. So let's look at all this in a ventilator and then see whether all these parts are there in our ventilator or not. Okay, so let's look at the ventilator which we have here and see whether all the parts which you said is there or not. Don't worry, whatever ventilator I'm showing you, you will have similar ventilators. Every ventilator has the same part. So don't worry about these only one single ventilator. All of them will have the same parts and all of them will have the same method of functioning. So here I have, what I have is an acutonic ventilator. Now you see from here, so I have an air connection, I have an oxygen connection, air and oxygen. So you see here, this ventilator has the back, you see, air, oxygen and air connector. Oxygen and air connector, these two are going in. I will not be able to show the low pressure, high pressure things inside this because it is not, it cannot be opened by me. But once the air and oxygen is going in, inside this chamber, there is a blender, there is a low high pressure chamber, there is a low pressure chamber, there is an FiO2 monitor. And from there, the gas is coming out through this port. So this is the inspiratory limb. And the gas is going to be cold and dry. That is why it's going to a humidifier. From the humidifier, the gas is coming into the inspiratory limb. The gas will continue to get heated in the inspiratory limb till it goes to the patient. And you have an expiratory limb, which is coming back to the patient. Now, since it is a corona time, we have a viral filter here before it goes to the out from the expiratory limb to the outside. Now you see that this is the circuit. You have one wire here. So this is the wire. This is the pressure port. This is the wire which measures the pressures in the circuit. For your pip and peep, this is what measures. This measures the pip and peep in the circuit. and displace it to the explanatory wall. This is the explanatory wall. I'll show you the explanatory wall. And this is the flow sensor. So this is the flow sensor. This is a flow sensor which is measuring the flows going to the patient and coming back from the patient. It's measuring the volume which is going to the patient and coming back. So this is the flow sensor. This is the pressure manometer. This is the pressure manometer which is measuring the pressures in the circuit and displaying, giving the feedback to the expiratory valve. And this is the expiratory valve. So the gas flow is coming here. This valve is, it's a diaphragm type valve. It moves up and down and then obstruct the gas flow going out of the ventilator into the circuit. So this is the inlet of the expiratory limb and this is the valve. So if you see here, this valve is a diaphragm. So this valve is obstructing the gas flows. So gas is coming like that. And this wall will move up and down or front and back. It will move to obstruct the gas flow and generate the pressures in the inspiratory limb. So it is lying like this. So this is the expiratory limb. This is the expiratory limb. This is the valve assembly. And here, this will move front and back to generate the pressures in the tube. And excess air will leak out to the atmosphere. Excess air, after building the pressure, excess air will leak out to the atmosphere. So this is how this machine works. And all the machines, you have to go back and see your expiratory valve, because expiratory valve is the brain of any ventilator. And this expiratory valve is guided by the software, which is setting the PIP, setting the PEEP and TIN-TE. Okay. Now let's look at the other part. So we have seen the hardware. I've shown you the compressed air source, compressed oxygen source, blender and FAO2 monitor. I'm not able to show, but I'll show you the display of them on the machine. Now, if you look at this machine. So now if you see the machine, can you see the machine? No. Okay, just a minute. Maybe we can hold it.
It has a night mode of display. Huh? Night mode of display.
Which one? Night mode. Okay.
That would be clear in contrast.
So what I'll show you is one of your holders.
We still, I think picture is not clear.
Okay, just a minute. We are trying to take the camera. I think you can see now. Okay. So what you can see here is, so you have, these are the set knobs. I said there are set knobs, what you have to set for each mode. Suppose I choose a SIMV mode, it will tell you what all I have to set for the SIMV mode. If I see for a SIMV plus PSV mode, if I click on that, so for a CMV mode, what I'll have to set? So these are the set knobs. Based on the mode which you set, it'll tell you what parameters you have to set. And these are what the patient is getting. So this is measurements. These are set knobs. These are the measurements. This is a digital measurement. This is a graphic display. All machines will have same settings or set knobs, then measurements, digital and graphical display of the measurements. So in this screen, one screen, you are having all things. Now everything which you, once you put the, suppose I'm putting SIMV. in this baby. Now it is asking me to set the expiratory flow. It is asking me to set the PAP, PEEP, trigger, expiratory time, frequency, FiO2, and oxygen flush. So this flush is only when you are doing the suction. And what we'll do is, after doing that, we have to set the alarm limits. So normally the PIP limit is 3 to 5 centimeters above the PAP. So we don't need so much, just 16. If the pressure goes more than 16, we'll give an alarm. And the PEEP is 4, we have set, and it is lower limit is 1. So we need to set 1 or 2 centimeters below the set PEEP. So around 3 centimeters is what I set for the PEEP alarm. The rate alarm is not the breath rate. This is detecting the baby's breath rate. So you should count the baby's breath rate and keep this alarm maybe 10 rates higher than what the baby is breathing. Suppose baby is breathing at 50, I will set this as say 60 or 65 breath rate. When the baby's breath rate goes more than 65, the machine will alarm. So basically this is what it is. All the ventilators will have the similar functionalities. They all have a hardware component. They all have a software component, and the software component or the display component is almost the same for all the machines, which is the hardware and the software. And the software is just what you are going to set for what mode and what you are going to set for what are the measured parameters and what that measures in display and digital as well as the graphic methods. So I have also told you where the problems can occur. The problems can be in compressed air source, compressed oxygen source, in the blender, in the FiO2 monitor, or in the flow meter, sometimes in the humidification and the expiratory one. So that is the basic component of any ventilator. I hope you understood that. So if there are any questions, I'll take one or two. Otherwise, we'll share the recording. Don't worry. Tejo, can we take any questions? So which part of the ventilator should be disinfected after every use? Yes, all the circuit should be disinfected, and the flow sensor should be cleaned, and the expiratory wall should be removed and cleaned and dry dusted. How does a single limb circuit function? It's turbine source of air inferior to compressed. So yeah, so turbine, nowadays you get a ventilators with a inbuilt air compressor. That is a turbine compressors. They're reasonably good, but the precision is not good as a air compressors. They're mostly used for transport mode, transport ventilators.
There is a question on compressor also.
So Sahil, the flow sensor is always near the ET tube. If the flow sensor is not near the ET tube, you're not measuring the gas flows going to the patient or coming out, which is not a good thing. You should always measure. The flow sensor is meant to measure the gas flows, and the flow sensor is meant to measure the gas flows and the volumes going to the patients and nothing else. Sometime humidification temperature, that I think Venkat will cover humidification. So if there are no more questions, we'll move to the next part, that is the CPAP.
I think there were something, trigger settings and other things they were asking.
So trigger and all, I think will come up in the science of PTV ventilation. So we will leave it to Ashish to tell us that.
Sure, sir. How does the compressor work was one of the...
How does a compressor work?
Yeah.
A compressor sucks the room air if it is a compressor which is there in the NICU, and it will compress the air which is there in the room itself. So that is why when you have a compressor in the NICU, you should keep it away from the walls and ensure that there is free movement of air around the compressor. And the compressor sucks air, so there is always a filter so that you have a biofilter. Whatever is sucked in does not have viruses and bacteria, you should ensure.
If you don't have a sensor, can we attach it?
So without a flow sensor, all ventilators are CMV mode of ventilations. Only flow sensor will convert a ventilator from a CMV mode to synchronized modes of ventilation.
How much? I think humidification will be dealt by...
Yeah, humidification, I think Venkat will talk. So we will hand over to Sai, Tejo.
Yes, sir.
Okay.